If you're an ICP fan, you do not want to miss today's video. I'm joined by none other than Kyle Langham from the Dfinity Foundation. We have a lot to talk about today. Kyle, thank you so much for joining us in studio. How has Vegas been so far for you?
It's definitely been hot. A lot of activity going on. You know, it's funny because you have, obviously, the Bitcoin conference is coming here next year.
Oh,
it
man.
It kind of feels like this conference is like a warm-up, as Vegas is like warm-up to the
crypto world. It's like the preseason.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then we just go straight to the playoffs, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah, we're super excited about that. You know, you are here for Rare Evo, which you're giving your keynote speech tomorrow. Mm-hmm. I'll ask about if you're going to drop any alpha in that speech a little later in the video, but I do want to start with something that's kind of taking over as far as conversation in the blockchain space, and it comes down to transactions, right? There's people bring up and they show stats like, hey, there's blockchains that are doing X amount of transactions per second, but a lot of them are fake, right? I'm not gonna name any specific blockchains, but we do know that around 60 to 65% of the internet as a whole, they're bots. Mm-hmm. But the problem I think a lot of people find is, when you talk about TPS and how much throughput can your blockchain really have, well, voting shouldn't really count, or should it count? So I want to ask you, what, you know, because when I log on to the Dfinity, the ICP hub, I see sometimes 4,500, 5,000 transactions per second.
Yeah.
How does that differ from how some of the other blockchains calculated? Is voting added to those transactions per second? Or how is ICP different from what the rest of the field is doing?
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple things there. Like, one is our industry, unfortunately, has a lot of vanity metrics that can be easily faked. So TPS is one, TVL are one, and yet those are probably the two most common ones.
Correct.
And by faked, I mean you could just set up a bot that, you and I can trade a token back and forth a lot,
right?
And that makes it look like there's a lot of network activity when there's not. The metrics that really matter, at least in my opinion, that I tend to follow is like network revenue. So like on Ethereum, how much gas is being burned, on ICP, how much cycles are being burned, because that's a little bit more expensive to fake. You have to spend real money to fake that metric. In terms of TPS, it's really a silly metric.
Why is that?
I mean, because, like, I don't know, when you use a website, do you care what its TPS, like how much throughput it has?
I just want to make sure my searches go through in a timely manner, right?
Yeah, so at least in ICP, you know, we're trying to be AWS without the A, right? So we're trying to be a decentralized cloud hosting provider. That's what we are. But the industry has this TPS measurement. So it's kind of like, well, if we're not reporting our TPS, it's more or less meaningless for ICP, because right, we're more interested on like how much data is being stored, how much computation is being executed, you know, how many transactions, native transactions are happening on Bitcoin from ICP. That kind of stuff is really important to us. So all that to say, the dashboard, you can see usually we're around 5,000 TPS.
Yeah.
That's real transactions. That's both writing data to a block, right? As well as reading data from a block. There's no voting as part of that metric.
Okay.
If you wanted to break it down, I would say it's about out of that 5,000, let's say 2,000 is like writing data to a block on ICP. And the other 3,000 are reading state. And again, though, a lot of these are just vanity metrics that
right,
the industry, for some reason, I mean, even TVL, like, there's ways you can fake this number.
You know, Kyle, I think the problem is, you know, in the world of macroeconomics and stocks, right, you have something called fundamental analysis, yeah, right? And so people are trying to figure out, and I think that's what stumps a lot of investors from the traditional world is, well, I can look at earnings per share. I can look at EBITDA. I can look at all these different metrics and see, hey, is the company's price, the price of the company stock, is it undervalued, overvalued, or fair?
Yeah.
And so when people decide, hey, is ICP at $7 or $170, is that fundamentally, is that a good price? Is that undervalued or overvalued? And then so people look at TPS, TVL, volume as their fundamental analysis. But like you mentioned, if those can be manipulated and faked, like, well, then people are stuck like, well, what do we point to? What do we look at?
Right. Again, network revenue. That's where it is. So that's two things. One is, I mean, A, how much, just raw amount. So like that would be the same as looking at a stock and saying, how much revenue does it have?
Right.
And then you add some sort of multiple to it and you get kind of a fair market value that you would think
right,
for that. That's one. And then the second one is like the growth trajectory. So not only how much is it growing month over month, year over year, but also what does that trajectory look like? You'll see like in Ethereum, you can almost just chart the crypto cycle to it. Right. You know, you have these big, big ups, and then you have, you know, in like 2022, 2023, it dropped like 90% amount of revenue. So, you know, okay, Ethereum's business model, if you want to kind of think of it in stock terms, their business model is highly cyclical.
Right.
Some networks are the same way. Some blockchain networks are the same way. Other ones are a lot more just, you know, you can see the growth trajectory is a lot more, I think, probably predictable or less like cyclical.
Yeah. So you're wearing a Chain Fusion shirt.
Yeah.
I know, you know, Bitcoin, ETH with CK, right? I know Solana is next or is working. Where are we at with Chain Fusion and what are the plans in the next, let's just say, 12 to 18 months? Are you looking to like go out on all out blitz and really integrate with a bunch of different blockchains or what's the game plan?
Yeah, I mean, Chain Fusion's a top three priority. Hopefully, maybe in this conversation, we'll get through all three priorities for ICP or Dfinity. Chain Fusion's the top one. Like, that's the here and now one. And so really, like, we have Bitcoin. We settled that back in 2022 with the native integration. Ethereum back in May. We just released a threshold schnorr a couple weeks ago, which allows, like, Taproot assets on Bitcoin, as well as chains like Cardano and things like that. Solana is EDDSA, so that'll be like the next integration. So these are all just signature schemes.
Right.
And once you kind of get one signature scheme down, you know, it kind of applies to a lot of different blockchains. And so the key there, though, is just getting to a point, like we call it like unifying Web3, getting to a point where you don't have this tribalistic attitude within our industry. You don't have these liquidity pools that are just completely fragmented. That all of that liquidity can kind of move back and forth. So liquidity can go from Bitcoin to Ethereum to Solana to any other chain really easily. From a user's experience, you maybe don't even know that that's happening right in the background. And then the bigger key, though, that I always like to say is ICP is not meant to replace Ethereum or certainly not Bitcoin or Solana. Like, these aren't, we're not in competition with these chains. Instead, we do some things extremely well. We have superpowers. And so Chain Fusion is all about allowing, you know, you've already built your app on Solana.
Right.
Like, maybe you want to extend your app in certain ways. Maybe that's accept Bitcoin payments, or maybe you want to have a high, you know, a product that has a lot of data storage needs. Well, you can use ICP for that. So you don't have to rebuild your app on ICP. You can just build that component on ICP
and
keep your Solana app where it is, right? Or keep your Ethereum app. So you can almost think of it as like ICP is meant to kind of like provide extra features to every single blockchain.
Right.
And that's what Chain Fusion kind of gets at.
And that makes sense, you know, and the first analogy comes to my mind is, you know, the airline industry, you know, it's all about, hey, if we're going to make a new plane, you got to think about, we got to bring the pilots in and do brand new training and spend all this money versus just upgrading a plane and being able to just not do that and bypassing saves people time and money. And I do think we're going into a world of interoperability.
Yeah.
And if we're going to do that, there can't be 10 different pain points. It has to be fluid. And I think, you know, a lot of the smartest people say that the future of blockchain is going to be people using it without even knowing what's blockchain. Like you mentioned, like, people don't need, like, do you need to know what a web service or a website's TPS is? No, you don't. Same thing.
Yeah.
All I know is I got Solana product. I can do ICP back and forth or interconnected different blockchains. So I think that's great. It's something exciting. I think it's something the industry needs.
I mean, that's the only way forward, honestly. Like, if when you go and you use a website, do you care if it's an Oracle database or an MS SQL database in the background? No. Like, it's a technology standard.
Right.
Blockchain is just a technology standard. Certain blockchains do different things extremely well.
Yeah.
And they're optimized for certain purposes. So really, like, you should be able to use an application that you don't care whether it's built on ICP or built on Ethereum or built on Bitcoin or all of those. But also, if you're a developer or an entrepreneur and you have an idea for a product or an app, you should be able to build that without having to make sacrifices of like, you know, my chosen blockchain is really good on this, but I can't do this on it. So I guess I just won't have that part of my app.
Amen to that. Right? Amen to that. Yeah, why pigeonhole yourself? You know, we did put something on our X page. We asked the ICP community, if you had a chance to sit in front of Kyle Langham, what would you ask him? So the the comment I picked was from Saratoshi Nakamoto. He said, quote, I'm assuming he or she, why does Dfinity keep pushing for an asset-centric model that makes the ecosystem feel like Web2/islands as opposed to one that promotes data portability?
Yeah. So first of all, when you post a question like that to the ICP community, I know it's going to be, it's not like when moon, it's going to, you're going to get some pretty tough questions. So, kudos.
Which is great, man, which is really good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It doesn't make my job any easier. but no, that's a great question. Satoshi's been in the ICP community forever. Is it he? I don't want to dock.
Oh, you know, okay,
much,
yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I'll say, is it he? But so getting to the question, actually, I'll translate a little bit. So what he's getting at is when I log into an app with like my internet identity, which is, you know, the one way you can do credentials on the ICP. When I log into app A, I get a wallet. It'll create a wallet for me in app A. When I go to app B, it gets a separate wallet that gets created. And the reason we do that is because privacy, we're very focused on privacy. Like when you think about what the foundation of ICP was, it was reinventing the internet so that it's more secure and that you can leverage blockchain in your core product. So privacy is very important to Dfinity. Now that creates a worse user experience, because if I have ICP on app A, let's say like OpenChat, and then I go use app B, I now have to move my ICP over from there. So that's not a great user experience. Now the question comes to like, why does Dfinity do that? Again, that's because we see the internet computer not as like, oh, this is a DeFi chain, or as in this is a Web3, like an NFT chain.
Right. You know,
we see it as actually a reinvention of the internet.
Right.
And so privacy is like, we want to get the Googles and the Microsofts. Like if you don't have the ability to use two different apps without those two apps knowing that you're the same user, then you don't have any privacy. Like that's just, that's how Google is making trillions of dollars off of you, is they know all the apps you're logging into. Now that doesn't mean that has to be the way it is. Like you can create a different a token standard, you can create different wallet standards, and people have done that. It's just they haven't gotten the adoption on ICP. And so I guess the question is like, I mean, he's kind of like saying like, hey, is Dfinity, like, why aren't they getting behind these things?
Right.
You can kind of understand it from the privacy perspective, but that doesn't mean it's an open protocol. So, you know, definitely, create the standard. Like there are standards out there. I know NFID is, their CEO is really pushing hard for the adoption, and that'll come. And so then you'll have basically like DeFi apps will probably adopt a standard that allows wallets to kind of move back and forth, whereas maybe more like traditional internet apps, like a messaging app, will probably stick with the asset focus.
Right. So. Awesome. And I want to give a big shout out to the ICP community for the posting the questions. And I hope you guys are enjoying this so far. I do want to ask Kyle, your speeches at Rarevo is tomorrow.
Okay.
So this we're recording on Friday. Saturday, you're giving your speech. Any foretelling or what is it called? Forecasting or foreshadowing? You can maybe give the people who might watch it before you speak live.
Sure. Well, I mean, we kind of touched a little bit with chain fusion. So if you understand what chain fusion means, that's one piece of it. My talk tomorrow is going to be on. So my talk is specifically about the value blockchain brings AI, and why should AI even care about blockchain?
Right.
I think I'm making the point of like, this is just the way the industry is going to go, because that value is so immense that the market will demand it. But if you want like kind of like the alpha, it's like, you can almost think of, I mean, I'm sure you've seen like what people are doing on ICP from an AI perspective is nothing short of just like phenomenal.
I don't think anyone's going to go against that. Yeah.
Okay, good, good. So if you combine that with chain fusion though, essentially you can think of ICP as the AI extension for any crypto app. So if you built your app on an Ethereum, but you want to have an AI component, but you don't want to share your private keys with ChatGPT, you don't want to use a Web2 plugin just to like, because then all of a sudden then Microsoft's involved in your private key,
right,
you know, storage. You build your AI on ICP, launch your inference engine. You could have your private keys using chain fusion technology so that now you're secure. And that's kind of like one avenue that I think is going to really, really light the crypto world on fire.
Dude, that's exciting.
AI applications that, yeah.
That's
exciting. For Ethereum or for Bitcoin. Like, Omnity Network has got this awesome AI agent that is just giving out like runes, right? Bridged over runes kind of a thing. And it's that kind of mindset of like, it's just like a little thing they did in a couple of weeks on ICP. And now it's like a product that they're like, oh, this actually is kind of cool. Might might be something.
That's the thing. Like, you see a product, you might not understand, and then you're like, oh, this is actually kind of cool. And it's just exciting. We're really happy, you know, that we kind of made the connection with you, Kyle, and we've had you on our show multiple times. We love what you guys are doing at Dfinity. We love the ICP project. We always talk about it, especially on our live show, there's few, if not any, protocols out there that have the tech and the know-how to do what you guys are looking to do, not just words, but actually working towards doing it. We talked about this off camera, and I'll kind of end it with this, is a lot of things that come into the spotlight today or tomorrow that everyone gets excited about, if you just did a quick search and look back 12 months ago, 18 months ago, 2 years ago, you would find that Dfinity and Internet Computer did that a while ago.
Yeah.
It's just now becoming popular. So essentially what you're kind of doing is you're, the team and the company is able to forecast what blockchain and crypto is going to need in moving into the future. And they already start working on and building solutions. And so I think eventually it's going to come to the point where people are going to realize that if you truly want great tech, great team. I know we talked about the massive amounts of cryptographers and data scientists you guys have at Dfinity. And so we're excited for the future of ICP, Dfinity, the world computer, the internet computer. And we really appreciate you joining us and gracing us with your time. And we hope you watching. We hope you guys enjoyed it as well. Make sure to subscribe to the channel for more ICP content. And we'll see you guys next time.
Appreciate you having us.
Thank you, Kyle. Thank you.
Amazing.